You're nervous? That's a good sign.
No, I'm not really.
Oh, damn it. I was hoping you would.
I want to be good. I want to be good because I listen to a lot of podcasts and I'm thinking.
Joining us from San Francisco, Mill Valley. Are you in Mill Valley?
I am in Mill Valley right now as I speak to you.
In God's country, Mill Valley, Mark Pitta. Let me introduce Mark Pitta to my listeners. You might remember him from a couple of years ago. He played the Federal Reserve. We interviewed the Federal Reserve.
Mark Pitta as Al Pacino.
As Al Pacino. And I asked questions about the Fed, because you're not allowed to audit the Fed.
And you're not, and that's why he kept saying, I'll let you ask this one time. This one time, I will let you ask.
And you kept calling me Kate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, and then I like how he lies at the gossip. He goes, did you? And he goes, no. The way he says no from that point on in his life forever. No.
Mark Pitta.
I hope he never dies because that's my best impression.
Mark Pitta and I started together in San Francisco. You are an empresario. You have been on all the television shows. You became a local hero on television in San Francisco. And mm-hmm. I have a bone to pick with San Francisco. This is my introduction. San Francisco.
Okay, great.
I'm going to trash San Francisco, and then I'm angry at San Francisco. I lived there for
Why, David?
It cured me. It turned me into a man. It gave me everything I have. And then I left. And like everybody who leaves San Francisco, I resent it because it's so beautiful, so idyllic, and I can't go back there.
And you stepped off the pedestal that was created being successful in San Francisco to out in the real world where no one knew who you were. But you achieved many highlights of a career when you left. So don't shortchange yourself.
I know. But the thing about San Francisco, now on today's show, we have Jeremiah Tower. Remember Star's Restaurant?
Funny guy. No,
you're thinking of Jim Hightower. Jeremiah Tower, Star's Restaurant, Chez Panisse, he created modern American cuisine. And mm-hmm. he left San Francisco as well and said, it's mm-hmm. a little too proud of itself, San Francisco. And I have a problem with the comedy community, something you addressed and fixed, but it's too big. Mm-hmm. It's too big. A problem now for you to fix it all by mm-hmm. yourself. You create a comedy at the Throckmorton Theater in Mill Valley, California. It is
11 years ago.
The best comedy room in the Bay Area. If you're visiting San Francisco, you have to go to Mill Valley. It's over the Golden Gate Bridge. And go see comedy at the Throckmorton. And hanging out there is Mark Pitta and Mort Saul.
There's a lot of famous comedians that have come through. And the reason it all started was because when I finished my TV morning show I had here for 5 years, I really missed comedy. But Live Nation owns the Punchline and Cobbs. I couldn't even get back into my home clubs. So I created a comedy night on Tuesday, and that was very strategic, as you know, because comedians are available on Tuesday. They're either done with their week or they're about to prepare to go for a new week. And it was one of those things that, hey, let's try a weekly show. But having Dana Carvey and Robin Williams as your friends, and they would show up, then a buzz was created. Then the audience thought they were going to maybe see Dana or Robin. But when they didn't, what was on stage was a lot of my friends who were mm-hmm. hilarious that don't have TV shows or are not famous. And it became a really cool core comedy audience. So they weren't there to see the famous person. They were there to see comedy, which is exactly what we went through in the 80s. People just went out to see comedy.
Yeah. And it's still going strong. Woody Allen has played the Throckmorton as a musician.
He's told one joke. He says, you know, we love coming here and playing for you, but we do it anyway. It's like that old joke where a man comes home and his wife is in bed with his best friend, and he says, Phil, I have to, but you? thing. We would play anyway. Yeah.
Go ahead.
That was so funny because I got to meet Woody Allen. And I have, well, I say I have in my possession, but when you go through a divorce and you don't have your belongings yet, you may not have this item anymore. Anyway, if I could do it quickly, Take the Money and Run was shot in San Francisco. That was his first movie. I happen to have a neighbor who was in SAG, and he's in the famous scene where he tries to rob the bank and they can't read the note. Well, he ended up with the Gub note. You know, I have a gun on you. Is that Gub? You know, the famous scene. He ended up with it, and he showed it to me, and he actually had the note in Woody's handwriting. And when he passed away, I convinced his wife that he always wanted me to have that. So I framed it. Yeah, thank you. I framed it with the lobby card of everybody pointing at the note and my neighbor in the scene holding the note. And I had it framed, and I showed it to Woody Allen, and Woody Allen goes, "Thank you." And I said, "I'm not giving it to you." And he turned into Woody Allen. He goes, "You know, I'm sorry. You know, people give me things I didn't mean to, you know, take for granted that it was mine." You know? So I have a Woody Allen story out of that. So that's cool.
That's great. Yeah. And were you there with Mort? Was it backstage at the Throckmorton?
That was actually, it was Woody and I were the only ones in the green room at that time. Wow. Mort performed earlier in the day, earlier in that evening. And my favorite thing was they're playing, and I go into the lobby, and Tommy Smothers is in the lobby.
Wow.
During the show. And I go, Tommy, what are you doing in the lobby? And he goes, "It's like he's blowing a kid's whistle. That is the worst clarinet I've ever heard." And I said to Tommy, so now we're just talking about stuff. I go, "What do you think of this whole Bill Cosby thing?" And he goes, "That guy's been like that forever. One time I hit him in his fist with my face." So Cosby.
Whoa, yes.
Yep. Remember that?
Well, we never knew why. We never knew why.
I think Cosby thought he did a joke of his or something like that, you know, on the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour. Something along those lines.
But who would hit Tommy Smothers?
I don't know, but Tommy's... I mean, it was so much fun to talk to Tommy as an adult, you know, because you grow up watching him as a teenager. And one time I had the opportunity at dinner to talk to him. Listen to this dinner, David. Mort Saul, Robin Williams, Shelley Berman, Tommy Smothers, Sammy Hagar. I mean, you're like, what? And I was at the other end of the table, like, why am I sitting away from the legends? So I walk over to Tommy, and I go, before the entrees come, I go, "Tommy, when you were at your height," I hope he doesn't mind me saying this, "when you were at your height of the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour, who did you have sex with?" He goes, "Terry Garr."
Wow.
"Oh, wow, she was really hot." He goes, "And then one time, it was 6 months later, I was at a party, and she was there. And I was trying to pick up on her, and she looked at me, and she goes, 'I knew you forgot.'" I'm sorry, I'm betraying his loyalty there and confidence that I would never repeat that. But when you're on the David Feldman podcast,
we get you. I gotta get you to spill your guts and make you cry. That's the whole purpose of the show.
I listen to a lot of podcasts, and I'm gonna just go against the grain here. I love Janine Garofalo. I don't know her that well. I think the last time I saw her was at the gym on Beverly Boulevard. We called it Butts on Beverly because they always had the Stairmasters facing the gym. So everybody on the Stairmaster, their butts were in the window. And I like Ginny because she would always call me by my full name. She goes, "Hello, Mark Pitta." She would always say it like that. But a lot of the times on your show and other podcasts, people invariably will talk about, "Well, I haven't had a drink in 18 years. So I'm just letting you know, I am having wine during this podcast. I'm not much of a drinker, but I wanted to, if I get a little tipsy during the podcast, it makes for a better podcast." I used to do Monster Party. I do that one. That's Matt Weinhold, and he talks about
Matt,
horror films. And they always get you drunk on that show. So,
well,
part of the podcast edition.
You're on the same episode with Jeremiah Tower, who is responsible for the snobbery of California cuisine. We can't imagine a time when people in Mill Valley and the Napa Valley didn't turn their nose up on other cuisine, but it's because of Jeremiah Tower and Chez Panisse.
Wow. Well, Chez Yeah, they have Chez Panisse in Berkeley, right.
Yeah. So what kind of wine are you drinking?
Well, I like this one called Freak Show. I did a gig in Lodi, and it was a Michael David winery, and they gave us a bottle, and I really enjoyed it. So it's called Freak Show. It's got like circus elephants on the label and stuff like that. If you still buy wine, I was surprised to know you lived in New York, David. If I could turn the tables and interview you, what brought you to New York? And I'm sorry if the listeners already know this, but I don't.
An airplane.
I didn't mean your mode of travel. I meant what spiritually brought you to New York.
I grew up in New York, and there was a marriage of a couple of decades that crumbled, and there was a job offer in New York, and I wanted to see my mommy. So I get to hang out with my mother and my sister and friends who I grew up with. And
wow, I never knew that. I guess because when I met you in San Francisco, I just assumed everybody was from there.
Did you really think I was from San Francisco? That's a compliment.
Well, I did think you were from there, because when I started, you were just one of the guys that went on stage like me, and I thought it was just all local guys. I didn't realize that Playboy article where Robin is quoted, and the whole article is about the Holy City Zoo, that was a beacon for comedians.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I must go to San Francisco. I read in Playboy, there's this small club. And they get there, and they realize, wow, this is a small club.
I got to the Holy City Zoo. I'll talk about that Playboy interview in a second, but I got to the Holy City Zoo, and I said, oh, this is fine. I'll give you my coat. Now, where's the club? I thought this was where the audience waited before we were seated. That Playboy interview, earlier in the week, we had Stephen Pearl on the show. And I saved my first calendar, October of 1982. Stephen Pearl presents. It was me, Kurt Weldon. And somewhere in storage in Los Angeles is this framed calendar. Rebecca Irwin put me on. And taped to the calendar is a piece from that Playboy interview with Robin Williams. So it's the calendar, and then it's too personal for me to talk about it, but there is a quote that I cut out from Playboy from Robin that I glued to that calendar. And that is my penis. Everything flows from that.
Yeah.
Everything
all
I got.
All the blood goes there.
That everything I have in life is from the Holy City Zoo. That's where I became.
Well, don't you feel that when you're learning something new, like stand up, and you realize, wow, I might be good at this, that those are special times no matter where you started. A lot of comedians have fond memories of Boston or Chicago.
Right.
But because, and don't you think that our group is so tight that we've never lost friendships, really, unless there was an argument. I don't want to mention the people who've passed, but Monty Hoffman. Anyway, I think that Monty was never a fan of mine, but I did like the guy. But this is a fraternity. You've been in the bunker together. It's like the San Francisco group in the 80s. So I'm still tight. I have Dan St. Paul, who was with Murphy St. Paul, Sue Murphy at the time. I actually was recording something in the green room, and I have Dan and I meeting on audio tape.
Really?
And we've been friends ever since. He goes, hey, I used to do an impression of Dustin Hoffman, Al Pacino, and Robert De Niro in a movie called We're All Alike. And I just would quote their, you know, famous scenes. And he goes, hey, you look like those guys. I go, hey, what's your name? Dan. Hi, Dan. You know, it's just so weird. I've known him ever since that day.
What's interesting about, Mark Pitta, what's interesting about you, many things are interesting about you, because I want to talk about the history of the San Francisco comedy scene. You are one of those people who is hysterically funny, and at the same time, you love comedy, and you're also kind of a historian when it comes to the scene. You really genuinely love the comedy scene. You are a genuine...
I do,
You are.
I'm a little insulted by comedians now who don't even go back and look or hear. I was at the Great American Comedy Festival in Nebraska, in Johnny Carson's hometown, and that Eddie Brill puts on. And
did you ever meet Johnny?
I did, but I'll get to that in a minute. But I'm at the festival, and the person getting the Veterans Award was David Steinberg. David Steinberg.
David Steinberg.
He did over 300 Tonight Show shots, right? So he's on stage with Eddie Brill, and Eddie's interviewing him. He's telling these great stories, and I go into the green room to get some water, and all the other comedians, the young ones, are on their phones. And I'm like, you're missing something.
Wow.
These stories he had was invaluable. My favorite, and I don't know if it's famous at this point, but he tells about directing Bea Arthur in Golden Girls, his first directorial sitcom job. And he was told that Bea's very hard to work with. I'll shorten the story in that.
No,
she is hard to work.
Don't shorten.
He said that he would direct her like, hey, Bea, instead of saying that line there, why don't you cross the couch, sit down and say the line? And Bea Arthur would say, why in God's name would I do that? Well, it's just a suggestion, you know. So at the end of the week, she always takes her directors out for a drink because she knows she's hard to deal with. So she's sitting with David Steinberg and says, David, why do people take an instant dislike to me? And David said, to save time. Which is a fantastic ad lib.
Right,
I mean,
right.
And then the young comedians are like not even listening to these great stories. And like, oh, like, remember being on stage and hearing another comedian? I think it was Don Ware. He was basically doing Cosby.
Cosby, yeah.
And you're like,
yeah.
Yeah, it's like, what's going on, you know? It's like, we know what you're doing, so.
Well, Larry Miller, remember Larry Miller, one of the greatest comics?
Mm-hmm. Larry Miller.
Larry
yeah.
Miller.
And you hit 70, yeah. Mm-hmm.
One of the greatest comics ever. Early on, he was a little like Robert Klein. I remember. Do you remember that?
Robert Klein was definitely an influence on him, yes.
Yeah. And then eventually he broke away from that. And I remember looking at Larry going, well, he's kind of been influenced a little too much by Robert Klein. And then he mm-hmm. broke free of Robert Klein. And I would say, I don't know why I'm talking about Larry Miller, other than Don Ware was kind of doing Bill Cosby, although I don't think he was doing the thing.
One time I remember this.
No, don't. I don't want to gossip.
I witnessed this. He said on stage, my brother, and I think I yelled out, Russell, because it was just too close, you know. My brother Russell, because I come in the room when the guy is just late. And you go, well, then you give him the pill, and he's crazy. He wakes up, and I got a robot. Is that the weirdest thing, though, that Mort Saul told me that Bill Cosby was always kind of an angry guy? It's kind of sad when your heroes are, like, torn down so quickly, but...
Let me ask you a question.
I can't think of any other way at this point.
I asked this of Robert Smigel and Gilbert Gottfried, and I'm going to ask you the same question.
Okay.
The three of you do a perfect Bill Cosby. How do you not talk like that all day? If I could do that... I would just talk that way all day. How do you stop?
I think the Al Pacino is harder for me to stop, to be honest with you, because you can go to Starbucks and order like him, and you get it right away because it's very intimidating. I like a tall, non-fat, no-whip, healthy fuck. You know, you get it immediately, right? But if you go Cosby ordering coffee, it's not... The thing is the water, but the water not too hot. You think so? Yeah. It's fun. I feel like a parrot sometimes. You know, the challenge is to come up with somebody new, and I've been trying just to do somebody new. I was thinking of Mandy Patinkin from Homeland.
Uh-huh.
And this is the only impression I have. It's really short. Previously on Homeland. That's basically it. That's all I got. I love your laugh, David. I think your listeners do too.
People say to me, you always praise your guests and you always, you know, you laugh. Yeah, I wouldn't have, why would I be doing this if I didn't have funny people? I'm not going to put on somebody, you know, it's not like I'm Anyway,
and
but
you don't have to fake laugh either. Now, because you've been successful, and by the way, it's my opportunity to tell you how proud I am of you. I think the last time I saw you in San Francisco, you were writing for Marty Short, his Broadway homage to myself. Was it called or no?
Fame becomes me. Fame becomes me.
Yeah. And we saw you outside, my wife and I at the time. Jeez, I got to say, at the time now. Mm-hmm. We saw you, and I was just happy. I don't know if you remember this, but you were writing for his character, the old-time...
Irving Cohen.
Showman, Irving Cohen.
Give me a B, I don't know if you remember this. Bouncy B.
Give me a bouncy C, right. So bouncy, you were writing one-liners for that, right? So do you remember this, that we were in the theater? I'm like in row 10, but you're like in row 25. And he does this joke that bombs, and you laugh. And Marty breaks character, in character, says, "Is that you, Feldman?" And then there were two other people laughing because we were the only person in the theater that knew what was going on. But that's how flexible that guy was. Yeah.
Yeah, he would. Is that you? And, or I told you that Feldman wouldn't work, Feldman. I told you, Feldman, that wouldn't work.
Now that I've brought you up and complimented you.
Yes.
One of the things I have on my YouTube channel is a KPIX news report on the rising stars of stand-up comedy, and they have footage of you just eating it.
Oh, wait, hang on. You're wrong. You got two things wrong there.
Okay.
First of all, I didn't eat it. I completely bombed and tanked it. And it wasn't KPIX. It was KRON.
KRON. Shannon, right?
Wayne Shannon.
And are you sure? Because there was a lot of news coverage at the time. Okay. Because you're on stage at the zoo and you're saying something about evolution, and you basically just end up, because it's on there, you say, "Well, yeah, evolution is not funny. Evolution." And you just kind of like, you just kind of bury it and move on. But that's, it sucked because that's all they showed of you at that point.
Well, you have on tape your meeting Dan St. Paul. You have always been a collector, mm-hmm, of the San Francisco comedy scene.
I know, and I was supposed to be the guy that wrote the. I was going to write a book about it, and then everybody goes, "Oh, you got to do a documentary," and then you got in there. We start losing people, but I have like the final interviews of Jose Simone, of John Cantu. You know, people like that. I have them, and I transcribed them, but I just didn't know how to work it into a book. So I think,
why don't you do a podcast?
I have one book. I was thinking of just, instead of doing a documentary, just doing a web series of the stories. Mm-hmm. You know, that way you could put a little history in there. But
the San Francisco.
I did meet Johnny Carson. I want to go back to Johnny Carson for a second because you didn't mention that. When I did his show, of course, I met him after, and. The thing about my appearance was when I finished, I walked back to the curtain. Curtain opens, and I walked right through, and I thought, man, something's missing. I never looked at Johnny to get the okay sign, mm-hmm, from him. I just was, I don't know why, I just froze. And then when I meet him, I go, God, I waited my whole life to get the okay sign. He goes, right. I was trying to give it to you. You didn't look back. But if you look at it, he actually goes out of his way to mouth, "Great shot," or "funny stuff." You know, he made sure people knew why he liked me. Wow. And then I said, "I waited my whole life to get the, I was trying to give it to you." And then I shake his hand, he leaves. And then 2 minutes later, he comes back and he goes, "I hope you come back."
Wow.
And I wanted to say, I have my calendar right here. And then Jim McCauley, who booked the comics, was really into giving people their first shots when he announced retirement. So I never got to go back. I did it with Jay Leno, but Jay Leno, it's easy to do. You know, I work with him on the road, so it's like, you know, you're doing his show, wasn't that special? They're doing Johnny with Jay's guy. That is weird. You know what? Do you have in New York antenna TV where they replay Johnny Carson shows at 11 o'clock?
Mm-hmm.
They don't have that in the Bay Area. It went Spanish all of a sudden. We don't get those, but those were great to watch. You see guys' first shots, you know, that, you know, now are your friends. And you're from the future because Robert Blake is sitting there, and you're like, "Oh, I know what's going to happen to him." You know, it's like I'm from the future when that show comes on.
I wish I smoked dope because I used to smoke dope and watch Johnny Carson, and would be. I know that if I were smoking dope now, I could feel like I'm in the future, I know I could transport myself back to the early 80s or the late 70s, convince myself that it's the set, and yeah. I'm from the future. I've been watching old Rickles. The San Francisco.
Oh, me too. I wrote a song about Rickles. I was so upset and I was so inspired that I wrote a song and I performed it at the Throckmorton on two Tuesdays ago. And I put it on YouTube and I put it on Twitter, and I called Kevin Pollak and I said, Kevin, I got 7 followers. I just got back to Twitter. Could you share this song about Rickles? And he does. And like by the end of the day, I have 500 hits or 400 hits. And then I sent one to Mindy Rickles, his daughter. And there's 2 versions. One is live where I do Rickles to the tune of Hallelujah, Leonard Cohen's song. And
well, you sang it as Don? You sang Hallelujah
so
as
I sang it. I would say things like Hallelujah. Now, how much do you weigh, Tiny? You know, do Rickles lines, you know, like Hallelujah. Is that your wife? Jesus, you know. But there's another version I did where I actually dropped in Rickles during the Hallelujahs, and I only had 1.9 seconds because, you know, that was the space I had to deal with. And he talked really fast, so I got them all in. But yeah, you know, you lose guys like Rickles. That's why I like to pay tribute, you know, because people don't know who these comics are. And he's, you know, he was doing it till the end.
He was doing it to the end. And
that leaves me this question to you. How do you want to go out, David?
Why, do you know something I don't know?
No, but I was thinking of Dick Shawn. I'm like, that could be kind of cool, dying right on stage. You know, that could be kind of interesting.
Dick Shawn from The Producers, comedian, died in the mid-80s. People thought it was part of his act, right?
His son was in the audience and knew something was up. He was the only one. He ran on stage, yeah.
But, to me, stand-up comedy and comedy is such a denial of death, and I just can't imagine it. And I don't like to, I just don't like to think about it. I just don't. Okay, you know what I noticed about Mill Valley, though? There's a lot of talk.
That was almost a Leno impression.
You know what I noticed about Mill Valley? You know what I noticed? I noticed that when you guys hang out. I can't do impressions. You know, I can do impressions around, for me doing impressions, I can do it around loved ones. Not that you're not.
So those two people really.
Okay. it requires me to be totally uninhibited. And I've worked, you know, like to do an impression around you is, but you know who gave me courage to do impressions is Robin, because Robin, you know, I can't even talk about him, and I'll see clips of him to this day and go and still be a little envious, you know, just go like, but he was not an amazing impressionist, which made him even funnier. It was just, you know what I mean? Like I remember watching him do Ed Sullivan, laughing my ass off and going, well, that doesn't even sound like Ed Sullivan. Which made it even...
He did the essence of a lot of people, but he never sat and probably worked on an impression like some of us do, yeah.
Which made him
my
even...
best
that
impression.
That makes him even more miraculous. Where and Dana... I don't want to get into this conversation. Dana... Anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, no, Dana, you finished that because Dana loves the abstract. Once he nails an impression, he abstracts it to the point of, like, you know, Bush never said not going to do it. Dana did. Mm-hmm. And not going to do it eventually becomes not get that. Love to just exaggerate it. So he thought it was funny. I don't work on a lot of impressions, but my favorite one, and no one does, not even Kevin Pollak, is Robert Duvall. And one time I was talking to a friend of mine who is like a second cousin of the great author Pat Conroy. Now, I read all of Pat Conroy's books, and when he passed away, I said to my Eleanor, my friend, I said, I wish I would have met him. And she goes, you did. You were with me. We went to Pasadena when he was signing book Beach Music, and you did Robert Duvall for him from the Grand Santini. And I'm like, oh, that's right. And I flashed. I'm like, that's right. I went up to him. I did. Remember the Great Santini?
Of course.
With Robert Duvall, like, you know, what does he say? Like, number 23 goes down. You don't come home. You're my sweetest little girl. And he said, I remember he said, put that on video and send it to me. So I did get to meet him, but that's my favorite one.
You're going
to
cry, too? You're going to cry? You're going to cry?
You can't gun down New York City police, Captain Sonny. The five families will come after us. The Connolly family will be outcast.
That's incredible.
I saw him once at the Four Seasons bar, and I just froze. Do you ever like to meet famous people? I always like to be introduced to them. I never want to be the guy that goes, "Hi, I'm Mark." You know, you come in contact with a lot of famous people.
I want to ask you a question about impressions. When you're hanging out with Robin and Dana and Pearl, do you guys just lock into, like, is it conceivable that you will spend the entire day talking like Bill Cosby?
No, but that, I'm glad you asked that. I was with Dana, and hey, Dana, throw on Grizzly Man. Okay, the Werner Herzog documentary.
Mm-hmm.
About the guy who lives with the bears, but Werner Herzog narrates it. And so I start talking like Herzog, then Dana starts talking like Herzog, and we would not stop because the guy had that, like, you know, Treadwell thought the bears were nice, the cuddly kind with the buttons for the eyes, but they thought of him as dinner. But you have to say the word bears.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're watching the Beatles documentary, 8 Days a Week, by Ron Howard, and during that, I go, what would Werner Herzog say about this, Dana? And Dana goes, even though Ringo would stand up to drum, but he could not compete with Paul's cuteness. You know, that would be hours of doing that. It's just for fun. Then no one's going to, like, where's the next Werner Herzog impression? Nobody cares. But that's one of the fun things about hanging with comedians, is you could just riff without a podcast being recorded or without documentary filmmaker, just having fun.
Right, right. I guess maybe because I'm afraid of doing Cosby and not being able to turn it off. I really think if I could talk like Bill Cosby, I know this sounds insane, but if I could do that, I would just be, especially now, I would, there's a reason I cannot do Cosby. Do you have to study? I mean, how do you do it? How do you?
I think it's like a person who can sing on key. We have an ear for music. We have an ear for impressions. And you know what? Now that you say that, it did happen with Dana. Again, we were driving to a casino right outside the border of Utah. And Dana's talking to the driver. And he goes, who was here last? And they said, Bill Cosby. And Bill Cosby finds out that Dana's coming next, and he goes, call me later and tell me how the boy draws. Like, he's got, like, a competition to go. So we would just do Cosby the whole time. If the guy doesn't draw, you call me on the phone. You make sure you tell me that there's five seats that are empty. But, of course, it's a road trip, too. So we're bored, and we're just doing good. And I heard that Cosby had to have cookies by his... He wouldn't sleep in the hotel room. He would sleep in the meet and greet room on the couch because he didn't like the colors in his room. And he would have to have like 15 chocolate chip cookies outside his door with milk. And he would know. He would know. There's only 13 cookies. You know, it's like all these eccentric things you find out about people. It's like the Albert Brooks story.
Well, hang on for 1 second. Hang on. You know, I've heard a lot of things about Bill Cosby in the past couple of years, but this cookie story, you know what? I cannot watch.
You broke it.
Yeah, that's it. Now I'm done with it.
Famous story. Albert Brooks's wife's mother lives in Mill Valley, so they were here for some kind of birthday for her. And Mort Saul was playing the Throckmorton.
Jesus
so Albert
Christ.
Over to,
how do you... Yeah, hang Albert, on, for, hang on for 1 second. Hang on for 1 second. Everybody's got to go to the Throckmorton in Mill Valley. I haven't been there in a couple of years, but I do remember it being like that. I just remember going, you too? Rob Reiner? What's Rob Reiner doing? You know, that it was just...
I know. It's crazy.
Go ahead.
I remember you on stage there. You were creating such tension leading to this pedophile joke, and you could just see the sphincters closing and people... You broke them by saying, God, I hope this is funny at the end. You know, it broke everybody up. But that's the essence of comedy. You create this tension and then release the tension.
Right.
And you did it with an ad lib, but it's like people were like, don't do it. We're all parents here.
Right, right.
But so getting back to Albert, Albert Brooks walks over to the theater because Mort Saul is playing that particular night. I'm upstairs in the balcony, and then I go down to the green room after the show, and Albert walks in. I'm like, holy cow, the reason I'm doing comedy just walked in the room.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd met him before, but he was hilarious in the green room. And it turns out that he's great in green rooms and parties, but he doesn't want to go on stage anymore. But there's this famous story of Rob Reiner's party, and Albert's holding court for like 20 minutes and breaking everybody up. And he kind of says, oh, thank you, good night. And he goes to the next room. 2 hours go by, Rob's saying goodbye to somebody at the door. And in the bushes, he hears, Rob, Rob, what? It's Albert. What are you doing? I left my coat in there, but I did so well. I didn't want to go back. Now that's fucked up.
He is very interesting in that he started doing the Tonight Show. Now think about this for a second. You did the Tonight Show with Johnny, right?
Oh, yes, I did. That is correct.
And is Bill Cosby there? Bill, are you
I did the Tonight Show when I was a young man and a pervert.
And how many weeks did it take you, Bill Cosby, to prepare for your Carson shot?
I don't remember how many weeks because I played the Vegas and I played Tahoe and I played Atlantic City and I came back and I did a couple.
All right, so it was a big thing for you. Well, Albert Brooks, Bill, was never performed in front of an audience. He performed at Rob Reiner.
No, I never did that. No, I did it on the phone for my friends and I knew it was funny. That's what Albert would do. He would call his friends, and if they laughed, he knew it was funny, and he'd do it on the show.
And Rob Reiner, Carl Reiner, the father, said to Johnny Carson, you have to have this guy on your show. And and Albert Brooks went from somebody's living room into 40 million living rooms.
I read that part in Carl Reiner's book about Albert as a teenager doing Houdini's son, and all he has around his wrist is this thin little... I'm probably not saying this right. He's held his wrist together by a piece of string barely made into a loop to hold it there. And he goes behind a curtain and he cannot get it off as Houdini's son. It's this whole thing like, this is a thing. I'll be with you in a minute. You know, it's just, you got to read Carl Reiner's book on that. But Albert was very conceptual.
What's interesting about just going from a living room or calling your friends and then just going directly to the Tonight Show, we have Jeremiah Tower on the show today, and he was talking about absolute taste. You know how musicians have absolute pitch? He has absolute taste. And he wrote a cookbook with all the ingredients and how to prepare the meals without ever testing it. And I remember Dennis Miller getting a special ready, and I said, where are you doing this? And he said, Faldo, I don't need to test it in front of an audience. I'm not a hack like you. If I think it's funny, it's funny. And then he...
Christ, Feldman, if I thought I had to do that, I'd been out of the business back in the...
That is genius, where you can just...
Know
it already.
Well, have you ever written a joke and you laugh and this is going to kill and then it doesn't? You're just shocked.
Yeah. Yeah.
And on the other hand, I do a joke in my act I don't even like, and it gets a big laugh. I go, I don't know why this is funny. But yeah. In 2006,
I wrote the greatest joke ever. Jerry Lewis had a birthday today. He's 80! Right? I go, and I did it backstage at the Ice House. I came up with it at the Ice House.
Yeah.
And everybody was going, that's amazing. That's going to kill. It was one of their anniversary shows. And I opened with it. He's 80. Nothing.
It sounds like lady, yeah.
I know. And somebody said to me, well, he's 80, which means most of the people in your audience don't know about lady. They don't know. Yeah.
I know. How famous do you have to be? You ever see the footage of Martin and Lewis throwing their autographs down to 53rd Street, and you're just, it's like the Beatles. It's just packed. How do you get to be that famous? That's why I think Jerry today has the right to be curmudgeon-y about stand up and all it's because he was that famous. You can't.
Well, I've told you this. I opened for you. David Schubert and I opened for you. You in the Bay Area. This was when we were all single. The women It felt like a Hard Day's Night. It really did. The women were chasing after you, and we had to go from the green room to a restaurant in Old Sacramento, and we had to run. And I felt they weren't running after. I felt like Ringo, and you were Paul. We were running away from female fans. What is that like to actually
cue
do
the band? Cue the band.
Well,
those were the days.
Well, let me ask Bill Cosby that question. We have Bill Cosby on the line. Bill, are you there?
He left. He left the room.
I was going to ask him what it's like to have women just fall all over.
They don't really fall over me because the water I give them first makes them a little hazy.
You know what? I don't want to quote other comedians without giving them credit, but Dana Carvey has a great joke on Cosby. He goes, what if he just was old and he just got the order wrong? Do I give her the pill and then touch the titty, or I touch the titty and give her the pill? Dana Carvey. Quoting Dana Carvey.
Gosh. Usually because... No, I appreciate that, but at the time, now, you probably, you know, I never dated in high school. I had one girlfriend in high school for 3 weeks, and that was it. So I didn't know until I got into comedy that when I got off, and I do jokes about being single, I would get off stage, and then women would approach me. And then I started hanging out by the door when they left. Hi, good to see you. Thanks for coming. So one girl would say, like, wow, you're cute. I go, would you like a drink? And that's then I got the confidence to pick up women. But back then it was just amazing. It was fun. But I don't know how to even answer that other than it was new to me and I took advantage of it.
Yeah. My mind is wandering to a time when the women who walked up to comics after a show weren't crazy.
One comedian, I remember, I won't say his name, but he turned down the girl because he was sore. That's how much he was getting at the time. Ouch.
There was a time when, and I'm not, maybe it's an age. There was a time when we were starting at that the women who were attracted, not to you, you're a whole different other story. I mean, but okay. There were women who were attracted to regular comedians and they weren't crazy. As you get as you get older, the women who are attracted to that's
something about my instinct. Like, why did I pick that person when they turned out so strange? Was it me? Am I not judging people correctly? But I had a female friend. I have one of those friends that is female, but she's like a guy in that I could tell her anything and there's no sexual tension or anything. And she said, well, when you're with a woman, they all want to think you're in love with them. So if you go in with that premise, that would probably prepare you for when things get a little weird, get a little odd, a little strange.
Stay on that for 1 second. So women think you're in love with them? Or they want you to be.
Women
in love with
want you to think that women want to think you're in love with them. Eventually.
Okay. And does
that's what my female friend said.
And are they in love with you?
That's the part where, you know, you're talking to a guy that's going through a divorce, and I thought my wife was in love with me, and you're like, if someone's in love with you, how could they act that way later? You know, so it's kind of sad. I wish her the best, you know, but...
Do you think men... Yeah, I know the answer to this question. Men need women more than women need men. Is that a fair statement?
I wish it wasn't that way.
But is that true? Yeah. That's true, right?
I think so. I think it has to do with men want to be validated by the opposite sex if they're heterosexual, you know.
Right.
So,
and what a woman.
Some men need other men, and some women need other women. So.
Yeah, but what do women want?
That's a book, isn't that the title of a book?
Yeah, but what do they want?
Mort Saul would say men want the love, and women want the that old fashioned protection, security thing. Does that still exist with women wanting and achieving heights of like, you know, David, bail me out on this.
Mort maintains, Mort Saul, the father of Monica.
Mort loves love.
Right, he's a romantic.
So, yeah, very much so. Because every movie he's ever written is about love, and yeah, that's where he goes from, yeah.
And yet his comedy is politics and love of America. And he gets up...
And movies. He loves movies. That's where Mort and I bonded. I'm not very political, so we bonded with movies. Like, the other day I was with him, and I said, have you seen my Darling Clementine? And he doesn't say yes or no. He just starts quoting it. Henry Fonda walks in and says, the bartender, are you married? He goes, nope, I've been a bartender my whole life. And he just has these little tiny pockets of dialogue he remembers. And then I would throw him a couple. So he likes me because we both like TCM.
But
he loves love, and he, you know, right now he's turning 90, and he's like, where are they? Where are these women I married that, you know, vowed to be in love with me? He's still disappointed. His first wife was interviewed for this biography is coming out about Mort on May 1st. I don't know when people are listening to this, and I haven't read it yet, so I don't know what his first wife says, but Mort goes, yeah. My first wife said, every day married to Mort was a nightmare. And Mort said, even the shopping? So he still has, he's still got his guns loaded.
Somebody should do a movie. I mean, going to Mill Valley and just hanging out with you and Mort Saul. Wow.
Well, if you want to see Mort every Thursday, he's on Periscope at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, and through Twitter as well. So people ask questions through Twitter, and you'll be watching Mort, and all of a sudden Albert Brooks will come on, or Judd Apatow, or Alec Baldwin. These people are really, they love to listen to him. But there's something to be said for living that long. You have to have more knowledge than everybody else, you know, and so he's still quick.
On Twitter, is it Mort Saul Says on Twitter?
Yes, and on 7 o'clock, you could click that and go right to Periscope. I just go right to Periscope. Like the other day, I was sitting there, watching it, and you know, everybody wants to talk about Lenny Bruce because he's, you know, he's the Messiah.
But it's Mort. It's Mort. But it's Mort. Mort. Mort.
Really,
Mort.
Is Mort.
It's
yeah.
Mort. Mort. Mort is everything. Mort is the text of comedy. It all begins with Mort Saul. It just does.
It really does, because that style still exists today,
and it holds up. If you go back and listen to him from the 50s, it's amazing.
He has a great joke, and I don't know if it's going to translate now. But when he was at the Carlisle in New York, and Dick Cavett introduced him, I was in the audience, and then he takes questions from the audience. Now I kind of set him up because I just like the joke. I go, what is your favorite political movie? And he goes, 3 Days of the Condor. At the end, Redford is there, Cliff Robertson. They're right at that building. They're at the New York Times building. And he says, I told them a story. And Cliff Robertson says, and this is the joke, he goes, now everybody on the East Side is going to know. So it was just a joke about who reads the Post and who reads the, you know.
Yeah, now everybody on the Upper East Side is going to, yeah.
Yeah, I was at dinner with Mort recently, and he sneezed violently twice. You know, those big sneezes? And I said, that really shakes you up, doesn't it? Mort says, that's the closest to death I've been all day. Because he knows that when you sneeze, everything stops for a split second. Your heart, everything.
Does it really?
Yeah, that's why it's a brilliant joke. I just thought it was funny, too, the way you did. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's true. They say that everything stops for a second. Yeah.
Hmm.
Anyway.
Maybe that's why it feels so good.
Don't you feel grateful that you're in a business where you get to meet and hang with people like this? Like the fact that I got to know Robin Williams the last 10 years of doing the Throckmorton, I saw him every week. We'd have coffee during, I would have coffee with Mort and Robin at Pete's in Tiburon. And you're like, what? Did I ever think this was going to happen? And because I used to hang around ball players, I know not to be nervous around them. I'd just be cool, you know. And that was insane. And then I got to meet, like, when Robert Klein was here. He's here because I go, I would like to see Robert Klein. So we just booked him. And he did an hour 45 on stage, and I'm not lying, 2 hours in the green room, just holding court with comedians. Oh, yeah, telling great stories.
Wow.
So, you know, and I got to meet George Carlin, and I got to meet Rickles once. And he did a Rickles to me, but not insulting me. I said, "Hey, Don, I'm Mark. I'm friends with Kevin Pollak. You guys are in Casino together." And he goes, Pollak, he doesn't know who he is. Always different voices. Pain in the ass." And I thought, okay, I got a little Rickles. And he was doing, we were at Pixar, and he was doing the voiceover for Mr. Potato Head for a particular Oscar ceremony where they're under the seats, Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head under the seats, and they have to talk about best actress. So this is Don doing his VO, and this is exactly how he did it. He couldn't say Gwyneth Paltrow. Yeah, there's a lot of good actresses. That good actress, that Gwyneth Paltrow, oh, geez, I hope she doesn't win. I got to see Don being Don, which is fantastic.
I met Don. I met
Steve Martin. Oh, good.
I met Don.
What's your story?
My story is very quickly, because I've told it a million times on this show, is I made a bad joke, and he says, "Only Jew in the room, and he ain't funny." And I went down.
When he passed, that's it. There is nobody now that will ever say what we feel.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
When I wrote that song about him, one of the lines was about being PC and how he stuck by what he did, and the audience that paid already knew what they were going to get. So you don't go there being shocked. You go there hoping to hear what you want to hear.
Saying what you feel. That's so interesting. Saying what you feel. Addressing the elephant in the room. That's what he did. That's what that was so amazing to watch him, especially on Carson. It was totally in the moment. He would pick up whatever the energy was and address it. Not really saying anything quotable. He would address the energy that was right in front of everybody.
Yeah, he was dialed in. My favorite one is on YouTube now. Him, Glenn Campbell, and Dom DeLuise.
Yep.
Dom was talking about a...
And Glenn Campbell can't keep his mouth shut.
And Glenn Campbell, I think, is drunk or something. But but when he says, you know, I'll just cut to the chase, Don Rickles says about his wife. My wife just goes in the bedroom and goes, "Got a minute?" And there's this pause, and you see Johnny, and Johnny already knows what he's going to say, and he's holding. And then Johnny says, "Well, at least your wife knows about your stamina." You know, and it's just like, or, you know, your staying power. And you're like, man, you cannot get this on TV anymore. Why? Because nobody moves down on the couch one. You had this dynamic of Peter Fonda sitting next to Gore Vidal, and you're like, how is that ever going to happen again? And I miss that when nobody stays on the couch anymore.
Why don't they stay on the couch anymore?
What is that? I don't understand. Where do they have to go? It's only 20 minutes left in the show, you know? Let's have Lady Gaga sitting next to, you know, Ronnie Lott or Al, you know, I don't know, but it's just, there's something that could happen from that, you know?
Everybody,
why are we running Hollywood, David?
I think everybody is a star, and everybody is controlled by a publicist who is going overboard to protect their client. And so they become like mobsters, and they'll say, no, Glenn Campbell can't stay while Don Rickles is, Glenn has to leave. You know, we're doing you a favor, and you can only have Glenn for 20 minutes. That's how it works these days.
You're going to have to answer for Santino, Carlo. Yeah, sorry. By the way, now Al Pacino as Michael at the end of Godfather says to Carlo, "Pacini's dead, Pattaya's dead. Today I handle all family business, so I have to." Who approached you? Was it Tataya or Pazzini? Why does Carlo answer? They're already dead. He's not going to get any confirmation. As soon as he says one of the names, he's dead. So, like, I don't know. He just said, I don't know. He's so fucking...
How many times?
Wow, how did I get on the Carlo rant?
Well, no, because I've had to give up The Godfather for 3 years. I've not watched I was watching it every night on my phone. And when you watch it on your phone, you see everything. People say, how can you watch The Godfather on your phone? I said, no. When you watch it on your phone, you can see every shot and you begin to see continuity problems. You begin to see, you know, if you watch The Godfather 5,000 times every night, it doesn't hold up.
Well, we all know that Sonny misses punching Carlo about a mile. You know, he's a foot away. We know that. But continuity problems are all throughout movie history. I like movie mistakes that are just specific. Like my favorite one is North by Northwest, where Eve Marie Saint shoots Cary Grant in the United Nations cafeteria, and it's this shocking thing. She pulls a gun out and shoots him, and it's shocking to everybody, but the kid in the blue shirt dead center, right before she shoots him, he puts his fingers in his ears because it's probably take number six. and it's dead center, so you can't miss this kid. It's hysterical.
That's interesting.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Speaking
My favorite one also is... Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, there's a huge continuity problem in The Godfather. It's called Godfather 3.
Okay.
That's the continuity problem. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
There are parts of 3 I like. So.
I know. Me too.
But, you know, it was Winona Ryder in that role, and she got a nervous breakdown, and Sophia Coppola stepped in.
Hey, there are parts of Godfather 3 that I think about all the time. There are actual scenes, you know, especially the Vatican banking story. And I always thought George Hamilton was underutilized in that movie. It's like probably George Hamilton's best role. The idea that they would have him as a consigliere was genius.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, it was sad though that, you know, Duvall wanted the same billing, the same money. You know, what are you going to do? I don't like that when sequels do that. But it's like with soap operas. Now the role of Thomas we've played by, you know, like what? So let me ask you one more question before we wrap this up, and that is, have you ever written a treatment for a film?
Yeah.
Okay. Is there a secret to it? I've been approached to write one, and I actually signed up, and it's only $90. I signed up for the David Mamet Masterclass because I just need a little guidance. I had this great idea. I've already pitched it. The people are really excited, but they need it on paper and, you know, register with the guild and all that, you know, when it's stolen. But I don't know how to write one.
Go get Final Draft. It's a screenwriting program.
Right.
And they have, within there, there's an application for treatments. And once you see the structure, and it's they have the template, you just start filling it in. And
okay.
Yeah. And, you know, the log line, and then it's...
Okay.
And, yeah. What do I know about movies? I don't know.
Well, it's actually, I was really inspired by a feud, the Betty Davis, Joan Crawford thing on FX. I'm like, gee, I always want to see a movie about blank. I don't want to say it because, you know, I'm doing it. And it's a biopic, but the person who owns the rights loves the idea.
Right. Now, does Steve Harvey, does he host that FX series? The feud?
No, it's one of the ones he doesn't. I think it's just...
Mark Pitta.
We
just scratched the surface. We really did, because you're right. We have to wrap it up. There is a history to San Francisco. So many great comedians came out of San Francisco, you know.
And were drawn to San Francisco. Yeah.
You know, there's
Ellen DeGeneres from New Orleans, you know, A. Whitney Brown, Kevin Pollak. Well, of course, that was San Jose. But, you know, the Solomita brothers from Boston. You know, it was just
Kevin Meaney, Dana Gould, Dana Carvey, Jake Johansson, Robin Williams, Paula Poundstone. You know, Rick.
So
I mean, you know, Whoopi Goldberg, and it goes on and on, and then it kind of stops. Kamau Bell.
Mm-hmm.
Kevin Avery.
Kamau Bell. Right, you could say. You know who I saw at the Throckmorton who ate it?
Mark Curry.
She knew she ate it. Yeah, Mark Curry. There's this woman named Ali Wong that I've seen her progress from when she started and now she has, like, I think something, you know, on Netflix. And you're like, I love watching people grow. And then it's sad to see when a person is, every time they're on stage, they do word for word what they did last time. Mm-hmm. So they're not working on their act, obviously. But it is fun to see the progression of people. And
Ali Wong is coming to New York. Jeff Wills just
posted. Yes, that's the one.
Yeah. And she's that big, huh?
Yeah, and she's really, I mean, you know, it was she bombed. And then the next time you could saw all the work she put into it, and she killed and controlled the crowd, and it was, yeah.
Well, how long has she been doing it?
I want to say like 8 years.
Wow.
To guess.
Do you see Jeff Wills at all?
Never.
Yeah, I never see him either. I should have him on this show, right?
He would have some stories.
Boy, when you talk about, this is a guy who took a job at Fox, not Fox, 20th Century Fox, John and Ann Fox, booking the punchline. he booked the punchline and turned that into the biggest comedy booking franchise in the world. I mean, he's Live Nation. He created, before Jeff Wills, comics didn't play theaters.
Yeah.
Right?
Do you remember when the punchline, if you went through the kitchen, you're connected to the old Waldorf, which was another Bill Graham club, mm-hmm. rock and roll. And I'm emceeing. It's me, Carrie Snow, and Bobby Slayton. Now, Bob Fisher, who kind of looked like a young Harvey Keitel, was the doorman. And he goes, and I get off stage, I bring up Carrie, and Bob goes, you know, Roy Orbison's next door. I go, can I go see some of that? Yeah. So I go through the kitchen, I'm watching Roy Orbison sing Pretty Woman, Leah, and then I'm going to leave In Dreams, and then he sings, you know, Running Scared. I'm like, oh, I got to watch Running Scared, you know. And then I go through the kitchen back to the punchline, and Bob Fisher is on stage introducing Bobby Slayton because I stayed a little too long at the concert. But that's how much fun it was back then. You could sneak in. Paul Prudhomme came. Bill Graham brought him, you know, tying all this, you know, taste about food into your podcast. He came, he was the first guy to bring Paul Prudhomme. And we remember there was this big thing of the old Waldorf, but the comics were eating alligator soup because they sent some over, you know?
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
Well, let's
man, I can't believe I tied up your previous guest with my portion.
Mark Pitta, how do people get in touch with you?
415-25 I need work. I don't know. Just Google.
Do you have a Twitter handle?
Mark. Yeah, I'm Road Comic 3, and I'm on Facebook. But I only, you know what I did on Facebook? Because I only friend people I've met. Because when I'm reading about people on Facebook, I want to know the person. So I don't want just to read 50 things from people I don't know. So, but yeah, Twitter. I have very few followers. I went off for a couple of years and came back on. But go to my YouTube page. I have a lot of fun videos I post if you like comedy. And Great. You can see David Feldman talking about evolution.
Wow. Mark Pitta, it's been too long.
I miss you. That's
I miss
what
you too.
The good thing it is about pot. You know, when I listen to you talking to Larry, it's like, well, you're in the room with me. So it feels good to have friends back.
Yeah.
You know?
Stay on the line. Hang on for 1 second. Thank you, Mark.